Even as Moses so long ago said to his Joshua, so say we in this hour of consecration to our Joshua, Chazak ve'ematz, be strong, Joshua, be strong and of good courage. Then as now, it was a time of leadership transition. Then as now, the tasks were many and the burdens heavy. But as Moses believed in the future, so too do we with confidence believe that our Joshua will lead us with the glories of his heart, the preciousness of his soul, and the wisdom of his intellect. Those qualities, divine in nature, are the very forces compelling our Joshua to be what he is, a teacher of Torah, bringing to us, we are his people, the collective wisdom of our people's past in the process of addressing the searing and searching issues of our time. Beloved God, be with him, our Joshua. Be with him and those whom he loves the most, and be with us, whom he will lead and teach, for blessing and benediction, and let all of us together say, Amen.
It's who we're running to. Ninu, Pitsu Viraninu, Visameru.
Pitsu Viraninu, Pitsu Viraninu, Visameru.
Pitsu, Pitsu Viraninu, Pitsu Viraninu, Visameru. Pitsu Viraninu, Pitsu Viraninu, Visameru.
Good evening. My name is John Stryker, and as president of this congregation, I extend our welcome to you all. Tonight, we will be sharing a rare and wonderful event, the installation of our new senior rabbi, Joshua M. Davidson. This is the first installation of a senior rabbi to occur in this great sanctuary in almost 40 years. Senior Rabbi Emeritus Dr. Ronald Sobel, whom we thank for delivering tonight's invocation, was installed here in 1974. Also, Rabbi Davidson was ordained in this space in 1997, and we are very happy to have you back. Over the course of this evening, we will hear from individuals who have had great professional and personal influence on our new senior rabbi, people whose friendship and instruction he cherishes deeply. The first to speak will be Rabbi Dr. Norman Cohen, Provost Emeritus of Hebrew Union College, our seminary in the Reform Movement. Rabbi Cohen is a well-known and respected author, professor, and teacher of rabbinic literature. He is also Rabbi Davidson's doctoral advisor and a close family friend. We are honored to have Rabbi Cohen with us this evening. Rabbi Cohen, welcome.
It all began over 3,500 years ago at a place called Ur, in southern Mesopotamia, today southern Iraq. It began with Abraham and Sarah, and then Isaac and Rebecca, and Jacob and Leah and Rachel, and the tribes, and Moses and Aaron and Miriam, and the judges, the prophets, the leaders of the great assembly, the early rabbis, the Tanaim and Amoraim, the Saboraim and the Geonim, the rabbinic leaders of the Middle Ages and down through the modern period. And now it comes down to this moment in this place and the covenant between a rabbi and a congregation of the people of Israel. Tonight marks the formal beginning of a new stage in the life journey of Rabbi Joshua Davidson and in the story of this wonderful congregation. You, Rabbi Davidson, like Abraham, have journeyed from a first moment of insight, perhaps even calling, about what your life had to be, to Beit El, to Beth El, and now to this place, to Emmanuel, Emanuel, meaning God can be with us, to a place with great potential of enabling us to experience God's presence, a place filled with extraordinary possibilities for you, for your colleagues, and for the members of this congregation. Thinking about this moment of covenant and where it stands in the long chain of tradition, the Shalshelet HaKabbalah, let us think about Jacob, the last and the youngest of the patriarchs, who is also called Israel and therefore is identified with the people of Israel and its destiny. The rabbis say that Jacob represents every leader of the Jewish people, every rabbi, every cantor, every educator who assumes the mantle of leadership, committing him or herself to the life of a community of Jews and to Israel's future. Just imagine the scene in Genesis 28 in your mind's eye, the beginning of Jacob's life journey and his encounter with the divine in his covenantal experience. And let us come to realize that this is our story, your story, Rabbi Davidson, the story of Emmanuel. Jacob, fearing Esau, flees Beersheba to return to Haran in northern Mesopotamia, where the ancestral family still resides. He stops for a night, places a stone under his head, and he falls asleep. Vayachalom, and he dreams. Vihine sulam utzav arza verosho magia hashamayma. He envisions a ladder set upon the earth, its top reaching to the heavens, and angels ascending and descending. For Jacob, this is the omphalos, the navel, the center of the world, the umbilicus connecting heaven and earth, where we experience the divine, where we experience wholeness in the world and in ourselves. Like Jacob, our leaders must ever dream dreams, have a vision not only of what is, but what can be, both for themselves and for those who they are blessed to serve. To quote Robert Browning, may their reach always exceed their grasp, or what's a heaven for? May they always demand of themselves first and then of others that they fulfill the highest that in us lies, which will give them and us the strength and faith that we have the ability to repair our world and repair our own lives. Yet at the same time, the need to be firmly grounded, the latter is mutsav arza, set in the earth. Leaders have to have a good sense of what is realistic, of their own capabilities and limitations, of where the people whom they serve are in their lives, what their values and needs are, so that they as leaders will be able to help them find essential meaning in their lives. And if they do, if leadership truly sees the faces of human beings, of others, then they will realize as Jacob did, Vehine Adonai Nitzav Alav, that God was ever present, firmly set right beside him. And God says to him, Vihine Anochi Imach, behold, I am with you, just as a sense of the divine can be with us in this place. Emmanuel, God can be with us. And finally, Jacob awakens from his slumber and says, Achein yesh Adonai b'makom hazeh. Like Jacob, may we understand that God is in this very place, at least potentially. And working together with the congregation's leadership, may you, Rabbi Davidson, have the ability to suffuse this beautiful sanctuary and this wonderful synagogue with kedusha, with holiness. If you do, like our patriarch Jacob, we will be able to say, as he did at Bethel, Ma nora hamakom hazeh. How awesome can this place be? Ein zeh ki'im beit Elohim. This place is nothing less than God's place. Vizeh shar hashamayim. And this place, this moment, is the gateway to heaven. Rabbi Davidson, you, like Jacob, represent the continuity of the chain of tradition. And along comes Rashi, the famous biblical commentator, and he gives us a gift for this special Shabbat evening. Rashi notes in this regard that there are only 6 verses in the entire Bible in which the name of Yaakov, Jacob, is written with an extra vav. It's spelled Yud Ayin Kuf Vav Bet. The O has a full vav in it. It's male, it's full. Ironically, Rashi adds that there are also only 6 biblical verses in which the name of Elijah, in Hebrew Eliyahu, is written without a final vav. Aleph, Lamed, Yud, He, without the U. It's defective and incomplete. And then Rashi powerfully suggests that Jacob holds the extra 6 vavs that will complete the name of Elijah as a pledge that Elijah will come and announce the coming of the Messiah. In effect, Jacob is the guarantor of our future. You, Rabbi Joshua Davidson, possess Jacob's extra vavs. And through your model, your leadership, your teaching, you will assure that the divine and the holy are ever present here at Emanu-El, the place where God can be with us. Therefore, we pray that you will be blessed with good health and personal happiness with Mia and Lena and Michaela, so as to enable you to fulfill your great potential. May you ever be an exemplar of the best in Jewish life. And as was said to Abraham 3,500 years ago, therefore we say to you, Heye bracha, may you be a blessing to yourself, to your family, to this congregation, and to the whole house of Israel. Amen.
We turn in our prayer book to page 50 for the Baruch Hu. Please rise. Please be seated. Thou art our God and Father, the source whence life and all its blessings flow. Wherever we turn our gaze, we behold signs of thy goodness and grace. The fullness of thy power is disclosed to us in thy gracious dealings with Israel and thy constant shaping of human destiny and in the marvelous works of thy creation. The whole universe proclaims thy glory. Thy loving spirit hovers over all thy works, guiding and sustaining them. The harmony and grandeur of nature speak to us of thee, our God, of thine infinite might and majesty. We rise and say together, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Be seated. As on page 52, we pray together. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be upon thy heart. Thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt speak of them when thou sittest in thy house, when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. Thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thy hand, and they shall be for frontlets between thine eyes. Thou shalt write them upon the doorposts of thy house and upon thy gates, that ye may remember and do all my commandments, and be holy unto your God. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart, and lean not upon thine own understanding. Remember all the commandments of the Lord and do them, that ye go not about after your own heart and your own eyes. His works and wonders surpass our understanding. His gifts and blessings are without number. As thou hast redeemed Israel and saved him from arms stronger than his own, so mayest thou redeem all who are oppressed and persecuted. Praised be thou, O Lord, Redeemer of Israel.
Cause us, O Lord our God, to lie down each night in peace and to awaken each morning to renewed life and strength. Spread over us the tabernacle of thy peace. Help us to order our lives by thy counsel and lead us in the paths of righteousness. Be thou a shield about us, protecting us from hate and war, from pestilence and sorrow. Curb thou also within us the inclination to do evil, and shelter us beneath the shadow of thy wings. Guard our going out and our coming in unto life and peace from this time forth and forevermore. Please rise. Praise be thou, O Lord, God of our fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the ruler of heaven and earth. The holy God, beyond compare, giveth rest to his people on his holy Sabbath day. To him our thanks are due. He is the Lord of peace, who halloweth the Sabbath and blesseth it. May the rest and quiet of this hour of worship refresh our inner life and renew in us the sense of thy holy presence. Open our eyes that we behold truth and beauty in the words of the inspired teachers of thy will. Animate our thoughts and endeavors with the power of thy divine purposes, so that whatever our hand findeth to do, we may do with all our might. Fill our hearts with Sabbath peace and serenity, that we may hear the voice of thy Spirit and be moved to build our lives on the abiding foundations of thy law. Our God and God of our fathers, grant that our worship on this Sabbath be acceptable to thee. Sanctify us through thy commandments, and may we share in the blessings of thy word. Teach us to be satisfied with the gifts of thy goodness and gratefully to rejoice in all thy mercies. Purify our hearts that we may serve thee in truth. Oh, help us to preserve the Sabbath as Israel's heritage from generation to generation, that it may bring rest and joy, peace and comfort to the dwellings of our brethren, and through it thy name be hallowed in all the earth. Praise be thou, O Lord, who sanctifiest the Sabbath. We pray silently.
You are the one. For this I pray. I ask you, God, to hear my words that pour out from my heart. I stand before you. I like water lift my hands. And grant me strength, and grant me strength to stand alone. Grant me strength, you are the one to whom I do belong. I do belong, and I'll sing my soul. I'll sing my soul to you. Sing my soul to you. In my heart, you are the one. For this I pray, and I'll sing my soul to.
Singing Reb Nachman's prayer with our own Cantor Corson was Rabbi Davidson's wife, Cantor Mia Fram Davidson. Cantor Davidson is associate cantor at Westchester Reformed Temple in Scarsdale, where she has served for 7 years. We will hear her again shortly. Now to address us are two men who have been and remain vital influences on the life of our new senior rabbi. Commencing in 1997 and continuing through 2002, Rabbi Davidson served under Peter Rubenstein, Senior Rabbi of New York Central Synagogue. Tonight, we are more than delighted to reunite Rabbi Rubenstein with his beloved Union Prayer Book. As many of you know, the formidable and most engaging Rabbi Rubenstein is stepping down this coming June from Central's pulpit after more than two decades of extraordinarily accomplished leadership.
Following Rabbi Rubenstein, we will hear from Rabbi Davidson's father, Rabbi Jerome K. Davidson. For many of us, the senior Rabbi Davidson needs no formal introduction. He has already touched the lives of many members of our own congregation during his more than 40-year tenure at Temple Beth El of Great Neck, where he officiated at many of our weddings, bar mitzvahs, including my own, and other life events. Following Rabbis Rubenstein and Davidson, the younger Rabbi Davidson will be installed before the Ark by our senior Rabbi Emeritus, Dr. David Posner.
I appreciate these words. And Neil, I thank you, especially for your friendship, which I think just ended this evening. It is true, I am grateful for my reunion with the Union Prayer Book, a book which, in fact, I've memorized and then left behind. I'm honored to be here with this historic congregation in this hallowed sanctuary. This is both a momentous and precious, and I would hope, joyful moment. This incredible congregation has been formed by people like you who now are sitting in the pews, and certainly formed by those who are sitting on the pulpit. I congratulate you, President Stryker, and your lay leadership. Of course, we are almost certainly grateful for the diligence and wisdom of your search committee, for all of you are responsible for bringing one of the great rabbis of his generation to this pulpit. And we in the Jewish community throughout the city rejoice in having Rabbi Davidson back with us in the hood, that is, the East Side. Above all, this congregation and its history have been shaped by rabbis, including my colleagues, your senior rabbis emeriti. Rabbi Sobel was among the first to welcome me to New York City when I arrived 23 years ago from Northern California. He has been a mentor and teacher and a guide, especially in the sometimes arcane ways of New York City Jewry. And Rabbi David Posner has been a great and trusted friend from those halcyon days when he first walked onto this grand pulpit as an assistant rabbi, and I was laboring in an unheated tent in the vineyards of Westchester County. I congratulate all of you, along with the incredible professional leadership assemblage which Rabbi Davidson now joins. And of course, there are no two people more essential to this moment than Josh's parents, and I congratulate you, Jerry and Gail, on another great moment. Congregation Emanu-El and my own synagogue, Central Synagogue, have never been very distant from each other, whether distance is measured by physical proximity or by its relationships between clergy or in its service to the Jewish community of New York City. But tonight marks a special bond in our relationship, for you are installing this grand rabbi, who have been, by virtue of his having been our associate rabbi, remains beloved by our members at Central Synagogue, many of whom have joined me here this evening. And I promise that if he is not already, Rabbi Davidson will very soon be beloved by all the members of this congregation in great measure. So what is it that makes this installation a bit more momentous? I'd suggest that the beginning of any marriage, at the beginning, no one can guarantee the quality of a particular shidduch, that's a word for match, whether it is the meeting of a future bride and groom or whether the match is defined by the ascension of a new rabbi to the pulpit of a congregation. You see, no matter how great the infatuation may be at the beginning of a relationship, you and I know that love grows over time. Enduring and great relationships are about character and decency and integrity and dependability. It is about knowing that you have each other's back. You as a congregation and Josh Davidson as a rabbi are independently exceptional, but your greatness, I know, will grow even more so because you are now together. What we also know about relationships is that the quality of any partnership is not only about the partners themselves, but is also reliant on the moment when they meet. So let us affirm that Rabbi Davidson's installation is being formalized at a significant, I would suggest, even a pivotal moment, not only for this synagogue, but for the Jewish community, especially in this city and throughout this country. We don't need the Pew report to tell us what we already knew. The Jewish world is significantly shifting. These are matters about which Rabbi Davidson has spoken already. But this we know. We know that now Jews do not feel an obligation to be Jewish as previous generations once did. We know that there is no one way to be Jewish today, certainly if being Jewish is defined by synagogue affiliation. We know that intermarriage has dramatically impacted Jewish life. Half of the children being educated in Reform synagogues are growing up in a family in which one parent was not born Jewish. And that number, I can assure you, will only increase. We know that our 20 and 30-year-olds are changing the rules. They are a generation that at best is indifferent to and might even abhor Jewish institutional life, certainly in the forms in which they were raised. That includes the forms which we continue to maintain in our synagogues. We know that while we may not be in a post-denominational period, we are certainly in an era of greater interdenominationalism. The borders between denominations in this country are becoming ever more porous. The members of our Reform congregations increasingly include Jews who have been raised in congregations of other denominations. And we know that except for the Orthodox community, which is growing primarily as a result of high birthright, the only other growing Jewish population cohort are those who define themselves as Jews with no religion. They don't deny their Jewish identity. They just accept their being Jewish as a matter of culture and ancestry. We call them the nones, N-O-N-E-S, because they find Jewish religious faith as irrelevant. These people represent one-third of our Jewish 20 and 30-year-olds. And what we know is that two-thirds of the children of this cohort are not receiving any Jewish education in any framework. So with this picture of contemporary Jewish life, we might legitimately ask, is there anything we can do as American liberal reform synagogues, and is there anything that we, you and I, can do personally, or as this synagogue, to influence our Jewish future? I proudly and unconditionally affirm that, of course, there is much that we can do. Leaving the specifics for other occasions, I would say that our synagogues, synagogues like yours and mine, Central Synagogue, need now to evolve into a new iteration, need to rethink all matters of membership and program and mission and especially vision, and need to be outrageously bold and audaciously courageous. There is a dictum in the Talmud, tefasta merubah lo tefasta, loosely translated, if you try to accomplish too much, you will accomplish nothing. In its popular usage, this is a particular Talmudic adage with which I take special exception. To the contrary, I say that in matters of vision, I believe that unless we attempt to do it all, we will do nothing. The secret of excellence is that unless we reach for the stars, as you heard, we will remain inert, unless we courageously believe that the unimaginable is possible, we will remain uninspired, and unless we boldly believe that dreams are attainable, we will be ordinary, and from my perspective, ordinary, good enough, is not good enough for any synagogue, and especially for a congregation which is as great as this one. And we, while we may not get it all done tomorrow, if we do not begin tomorrow, inertia will set in and we will accomplish nothing. Our people know that all around us change is afoot. That's not a surprise. Thus, we are mourning Nelson Mandela, who made change the very essence of his life and proved, if nothing else, that everything is possible. Jews want their synagogues to call them to sacred purpose, and we must. Jews want their synagogues to inspire them with a holy mission, and we must do that as well. Our members have the right to believe this world can be better and that our synagogues will be part of making it so. We have the responsibility to affirm Jewish life. Jewish organizations and our synagogues should matter and make a difference in their own institutional lives and to our personal lives, and that we most certainly must do. But our synagogues must also matter outside these walls of ours. Your congregation's greatness is that you have the substance, spiritual and otherwise. You have the membership and the commitment to do all of this. You have the history of doing all of this. You have the strength and the institutional backbone to help lead the way into a new age of Jewish life, and I promise you we need that new age. And in keeping with the noble rabbinic tradition of this congregation, you have a new rabbi, this incredible rabbi, who will help by leading you to the greatness of the next chapter of this congregation's history. This I promise you, Rabbi Josh Davidson will speak the truth. Together with you, he will form the vision. He will fearlessly and boldly and proudly move forward with you and embrace you every step of the way. He will extend himself to you with a gentle hand and guide you forward with his inimitable decency and his impeccable character. He will launch you courageously and sensitively into the next generation of Jewish life and institutional meaning. He is an unusual soul. But for success in all this, he needs you by his side, for that is the formula for excellence. I have the faith that with courage and bold vision, Congregation Emanu-El and Rabbi Joshua Davidson standing side by side and hand in hand will lift the entire Jewish community of this city, and yes, even this nation, will lift us forward, and it will be for greatness and excellence, and it will be for the mission for which we were born into history, and it will be in service of Jewish survival, and it will be another great chapter in the inspiring story of this amazing congregation. And that is what makes this a momentous and precious moment, for it all begins here, tonight, with you and with him. You have so much to do, so I would hope you get on with it. May God bless your incredible venture and your incredible adventure. And I promise you, you will be a blessing for us all. And for that, we will be grateful. Amen.
Indeed, this is a night so filled with beauty and meaning in so many ways. After those powerful words that we have already heard from the voices of many, I can't help but recall the rabbi who was confronted by a smiling lady after he had preached a sermon, and she came up to him and said, "Rabbi, you were superfluous." My dear friend and congregant in Great Neck, retired Chief Judge of New York, Saul Wachler, sent us a note on the occasion of this installation service. He wrote, "I was with Mario Cuomo the other day, and I told him that he must feel great pride in his son, Andrew. Mario responded that he, Mario, deserves no credit and therefore feels no pride, that it was Andrew who must be proud of himself. When he said that," Saul wrote, "I thought he was wrong. I believe that when a son or daughter achieves such a high degree of accomplishment and recognition, the joy of the achievement should be shared with the parents. Now, Gail and I, and Josh's brother Jeremy, and of course Mia, and her parents, Dr. David and Carol Fram, all agree with both thoughts. Joshua deserves to be very proud of himself, and we delight in sharing pride and joy with him, and indeed with all of you. I'm often asked if I am pleased that Joshua became a rabbi following my footsteps. Yes, but not for the reasons that you might think. We all want the same for our children, I suspect, that they find satisfactions of accomplishment and delight, of fulfillment in their chosen careers. And I would have been happy with what I had once assumed to have been his selected field of endeavor. I was reminded of this when, in going through boxes in preparation for a forthcoming move into New York City from Great Neck, I discovered a pile of letters from all around the country addressed to Joshua at the time of his graduation from his beloved Princeton. He had applied to be a baseball radio announcer with the Boise Hawks, the Gastonia Rangers, the Utica Blue Sox, the Eugene Emeralds, and about 20 other ball teams. They responded with appreciation for his interest, but stated, "We're very sorry, but there are no jobs available. So we Davidsons are really glad that he got this job." And that his years at the Hebrew Union College, Central Synagogue, and Chappaqua all prepared him for it so well. It's wonderful to share this service with Temple Emanuel's distinguished senior rabbis emeriti, David Posner and Ronald Sobel, with rabbis Amy Ehrlich and Ben Seidman and cantor Lori Corson, and rabbinic and cantorial interns, Alexis Pinsky and Richard Newman, and of course with your Temple fine president, John Stryker. And no less with so many of Joshua's mentors and teachers, Professor Norman Cohn, Rabbi Peter Rubenstein, Rabbi David Gelfand, cantor Ellen Dreskin. You know, together we installed him at Temple Beth El in Chappaqua a decade ago. And we've decided, however, no more installations. This is it. Of course, we do know that Josh will be a fine spiritual leader at Temple Emanuel because of his great sensitivity, sound judgment, terrific sense of humor, and warm and compassionate heart. And that's all I'm going to say about his qualities, except for one memory which none of his other teachers or mentors could possibly have shared. And so it becomes the text of my words for tonight. When Joshua was a little kid, maybe 5 years old, he would run into my office after religious school and go over to the table where the big shofar rested, a long, curled ram's horn. Standing upright, it was easily as tall as he. Joshua would pull it over to the sofa. He couldn't lift it, in my study, rest it on the pillows, stand at one end, and blow as hard as he could. After a while, he was able to make a pretty fair sound. When he was 8 or 9, I asked our temple shofar blower, Dr. Adam Bender, to teach him the calls. With all due respect to Rabbi Posner, Dr. Bender was, in my life, then the best. The very, very best. He actually having been at Mount Sinai Hospital, that is, and Joshua was soon blowing the shofar for children's high holiday services. When Joshua was a young teenager, Dr. Bender moved away, and as some of you who are here will well remember, Joshua took over the shofar blowing for the adult services as well. I could be accused of being guilty of nepotism, I guess, but it was great and we loved it. The producers of the Abba Eban TV special on Jewish history needed a shofar call as part of their background music. They evidently heard about Joshua, and it was he who recorded the calls with a full orchestra in a studio in New York. His pay was to order any kind of sandwich that he wanted from the Carnegie Delicatessen. I forget what he ordered, but I'll bet that he does remember. And speaking of the Carnegie Delicatessen, one time years ago when we were eating there as a family, Joshua looked over to the adjoining booth and said to us, "Don't look now, but the number one sandwich is sitting behind you." It was Marv Alpert, I think, one of his heroes from that other profession. At the biblical Mount Sinai, when the Ten Commandments were given to Moses, we read in Exodus, "Vayehi kol ha-shofar holech v'chazek ma'od." The sound of the shofar grew louder and louder. And that is really the way it seemed as you, Joshua, learned to blow the shofar. The congregation was always amazed as you held the long note, tekiah gedolah. Instead of the sound growing thinner and weaker, it actually did grow louder and stronger. The shofar, Joshua, is your special sound, your voice. But it is also Judaism's voice. It challenges us on Rosh Hashanah, as Maimonides interpret it. "Awake, you sleepers, rouse yourselves, examine your deeds." I hope the shofar call will always be a powerful symbol for your rabbinate. However, your people will not hear the voice of the shofar as clearly as they do in the stillness of this awesome sanctuary. There are so many other sounds, other voices that will drown out the voice of faith we strive to speak. The sounds of terrorist bombs, bombs blasting life away in so many lands, the horror of ubiquitous gunfire in schools, on college campuses, in city streets, including those of our own, as mindless gun advocates lobby to assure the availability of assault weapons for the next sick killer, the arrogant babble of corporate criminals claiming they did nothing illegal, the voices of cover-up denying sexual abuse in universities and churches, and sadly, Jewish communities, the heartless calls for the cutting of SNAP, formerly food SNAPs, when 1 in 6 children in the United States goes hungry every day. That shofar sound must somehow penetrate the cacophony of cynicism, lies, violence, and despair that is so pervasive and reflect the religion of protest that Judaism has always been. It needs to rise above the world's din if we as rabbis are to bring our people and humanity the values and dreams enshrined within our faith. Let your voice, Joshua, call to your people here at Temple Emanu-El with the wisdom and vision of our rich tradition. Your experiences and your mentors have prepared you. Through your interfaith pilgrimage to Mississippi as your brother before you, you became witness to the pain of poverty and racism. You've led many congregational trips to Israel to teach the central role and responsibility you believe Israel's existence and future represent to American Jews. Your mission into the West Bank with Rabbis for Human Rights, protesting at some great risk with your physical presence, the Jewish settlers' vandalism of Palestinian farmers' olive trees at harvest time, reflected your deep humanitarian ideals. You traveled to Russia with colleagues and learned from Natan Sharansky how families, especially children, are rediscovering the treasure of their Jewish identity buried within them. What an inspiration as you seek to, as Rabbi Rubinstein challenged you, renew Jewish life in the hearts of the younger generation of American Jews. Yet you face a daunting task. When you were a little boy, you and Jeremy used to run around the big sanctuary in our temple, up and down the ramp and balcony, and once you asked me when you'd returned, "Dad, why are there so many exit signs, so many ways to get out?" Well, there are a lot of ways to get out of Jewish duty. People will say, "I'm too busy to attend adult education classes, to work in the temple's soup kitchen, to serve on a committee. You should know what goes on in my office or in my home." It's a pick and choose Judaism today, as we know the studies report. Whatever you want, enough. A big bar mitzvah or bat mitzvah, and it's over until the next generation. And on Yom Kippur, many will say, "Wonderful sermon, Rabbi. Have a nice year." On Sinai, as the sound of the horn grew louder, God told Moses repeatedly, "Lech Reid, go down to the people, speak to them, inspire them." Our only hope is to touch and move our people to share our dreams and carry them with us and beyond us. Thus, we strive to call our people to the mountain of our inspiration. I know, Josh, you will bring your people to the mountain. You will forge new paths to help them find God here. You will promote effective outreach to the growing diversity of our families and to those who need and deserve the welcome of a caring Jewish community. In a world that beats plowshares into swords, that tolerates hunger amid plenty and expects politicians to lie, I am certain you will be unrelenting in leading your congregation to raise its voice for righteousness and justice. And I know with your heart you will embrace your congregants, all of them. The insecure teenager standing alone, the husband or wife who has lost the key to a home full of warmth and love, a parent isolated from her child, a bereaved soul whose partner is gone forever. You will reach out with a hug, with words of confidence and friendship. You will be there as a lighthouse in the night, as a voice saying, "I am here, you can trust me, and the faith I represent." Just over 50 years ago, Rabbi Jacob Philip Rudin, whom you and others here from Temple Bethel of Great Neck remember so fondly, and whose words you read over and over again for renewal, addressed the rabbinic ordination class of the Hebrew Union College. His concluding words to these young rabbis about to go forth to their congregation: "So what do? You keep the Torah near, and you teach them its eternal truths. You bring a big world to their little one. You give their lassitude no peace. You light a candle, however small, against the darkness, however great. You go forward when others say, stand still. You speak when others say, keep silence. You look to the far horizon." Dear Joshua, I know you will do all this and more. with your knowledge, your courage, and your spirit. And because you will do so, indeed the shofar sound will grow stronger and stronger. Amen.
Ribono shel Olam, Master of the Universe, be with thy child, Rabbi Joshua Davidson, as he accepts responsibility for this community. Strengthen his arms as he cradles thy children in celebration and in sorrow. Sustain his heart, that he may open other hearts to thy presence. Uplift his spirit, that he may lead prayer, which makes you manifest. Help him to learn and to teach, to counsel and to comfort, to enrich and to inspire. May the law of love always be found on his lips, and may he, by precept and example, lead us in the ways of righteousness. Strengthen the spirit of this congregation and all its members. May they never be afraid to break their rabbi's back with hard work. But please, dear God, may they never break his heart with indifference. May God's light forever shine upon him. May his life be a blessing for his family, for his colleagues, for his congregation, and for all who love him. Amen.
Dear Josh, may God continue to bless you in heart and mind, that you may bring your own authentic voice of our faith to this great congregation. May the joy and gladness you share with your beloved Mia, Lena, and Michaela ever strengthen you on your journey in the years ahead. May God bless you in abundance with the gift of enduring love and peace. Amen.
Adonai Adonai HaKadosh, may your eye
space between the letters of the scrolls. Bring warmth and comfort to your soul. Oh, may your eyes sparkle with the light of Torah, and may
And so Jacob proclaimed, Ma nora hamakom hazeh, how awesome is this place. And that is how I feel. How awesome is this sanctuary and the magnificent congregation which fills it. How awesome this moment in my life, a dream come true. No words could adequately convey the depth of my gratitude to our temple's officers and trustees who made it so, or to all of you, countless individuals and families who have already welcomed me into your lives. But there are certain angels I will at least begin to thank. First, my colleagues, Rabbis Amy Ehrlich and Ben Zeidman, and cantor Lori Corson, whose musical offerings tonight and always are simply breathtaking. Amy, Ben, and Lori have been your friends and supports, and now they are mine, and I am so grateful, especially to Rabbi Ehrlich, your cherished rabbi these 25 years, whose warmth and wisdom are boundless. And I thank our interns, Alexis Pinsky and Richard Newman, our magnificent choir, our organist, Scott Warren, and Dr. Andrew Henderson. To our beloved, devoted administrative vice president and Skirball Center director, Dr. Mark Weistuck, the brilliant teacher and engineer who has kept the train running on time for almost 30 years, and the extraordinary Mark Heitlinger, the glue, who has held us together for 25. To those who guide our development, life cycle, nursery and religious school, family, youth, adult learning, library, museum, and communications programs, Robin Symbol, Sherry Nehmer, Ellen Davis, Saul Kaiserman, Rachel Brumberg, Rabbi Rena Rifkin, Missy Bell, Elisa Schindler-Frankel, Rachel Dulitz, Liza Stabler, Warren Klein, Catherine Roberts, and Josh Barron, every one of them so gifted. To these Malachi Elohim, to these angels, to Bobby Rambali, Joe Bisram, and all the members of our staff family, including my own assistant, Elizabeth Fevrin, my profound gratitude. To Linda DeLott, Gary Dean, Carol Hess, Shelley Katz, and the Tikkun Olam Committee for adding meaning to this celebration by making it not just about us, but about those who need us. And to all of you who brought books for low-income city families and their children tonight, and those standing by to collect them, my great thanks. To tomorrow's Benot Mitzvah, Glynis Reed and Shana Stein, for sharing their moment with me. to Marsha Waxman, immediate past president, and her search committee who brought me here, to Neil Cooper, our installation chair, and his tireless committee who planned this night, including our vice president, the Honorable Susan Danoff, trustee John Sorkin, whom I've known since nursery school, administrator Mark Heitlinger, who, as always, attended with love to every detail, to Jessica Weber and Tyler Bush for the beautiful invitation and program, and of course, to our esteemed president, John Stryker, about whom I would simply say, every senior rabbi should be blessed to have so supportive a partner and friend. And I look forward with such excitement to continuing this journey with him. As John said at the outset, this evening has brought together people who have influenced my life and rabbinate in the profoundest ways. My friends from Great Neck and Beetlebung Corner, from Temple Beth El of Northern Westchester and Central Synagogue, whose leadership just yesterday selected their next senior rabbi, the brilliant Angela Buchdahl. I deeply appreciate all of you being here. And I want to acknowledge with great affection the leaders of our movement, Rabbi Rick Jacobs, the visionary president of the Union for Reform Judaism, Steve Sachs, chairman of its board, Rabbi Dr. David Ellenson, president of the Hebrew Union College Jewish Institute of Religion and my beloved professor of Jewish thought, and his successor, Rabbi Dr. Aaron Pankin, president-elect of the College Institute. I would also welcome, with special joy, he will be teaching us this winter, the Vice President Emeritus of our movement, Albert Vorspan. This spring's Charles Grossman Lecturer, the great luminary of synagogue renewal, Rabbi Dr. Lawrence Hoffman. And our preacher, in celebration of the Martin Luther King Jr. holiday on January 17th, the Reverend Dr. Calvin Butts. On that day, we will remember two King's brother in spirit, Nelson Mandela, whose life was a precious gift to the human family and whose passing we mourn. There are many governmental and religious leaders present tonight from as far away as Jerusalem. While I cannot possibly name them all, I'm so grateful to each of them. With many, I serve on a partnership of faith in New York, an organization chaired by Rabbi Peter Rubenstein, and founded by our Rabbi Emeritus, Dr. Ronald Sobel, the courageous visionary who led this congregation for almost 30 years and whose invocation tonight was, as his support has been since my arrival, endlessly gracious. Thank you, Ronnie. And thank you to my cherished friend and immediate predecessor, Rabbi Emeritus, Dr. David Posner, the pastor of this congregation whom I humbly succeed. David, though you entrust me with your flock, you will always be their great shepherd. The others who surround me tonight were also present 11 years ago as I began my tenure in Chappaqua, and they are my moorings. Rabbi David Gelfand and Cantor Ellen Dreskin, who will deliver the benediction, have been a presence in my life since I was a boy of 10 and provided for me the youth and then the professional opportunities that set me on my way. Rabbi Dr. Norman Cohn is my beloved teacher of Torah. Rabbis strive to be clay kodesh, vessels for holiness. And in the truest sense, he is. To be able to carry Torah into the lives of one's people and lift it up as a mirror in which we see ourselves as we are and as we might become is a goal to which every rabbi aspires, but a gift which Norman possesses like no one else. Rabbi Peter Rubenstein, Central Synagogue's uniquely gifted senior rabbi, my beloved mentor, who afforded me the chance to grow into my own rabbinate, my constant supporter and booster, whose genius I strive to emulate and on whom I continue to lean for wisdom, humor, and perspective. and Rabbi Jerome Davidson. Simply the model for what a congregational rabbi should be. A leader empowered by Torah, by his love for his people and by theirs for him, who emboldens them to make Judaism's highest social vision a reality in our world, who never pressured me to go into the rabbinate, but inspired me to go into it. I love you. And to our family. My mother, Dr. Gail Davidson, curator at the Cooper Hewitt Museum at the top of her field, whose wisdom and perspective as both a rabbi's mother and a rabbi's wife, I count on, and whose love and support are unconditional. My brother Jeremy, a gifted and beloved music teacher at the Cadman School and the most wonderful brother and friend. My aunt and uncle Greer and Jerry Goldman, and my in-laws David and Carol Fram. My daughters, Lena and Michaela, who make my heart beat. Most of all, my wife, Mia, who makes it beat faster and with purpose. She is the love of my life and my rock. In moving to New York, I turned our lives upside down. She righted them. But that is what she has done for me every day since we met. Mia, of course, is the wonderful associate cantor of Westchester Reformed Temple. How can I even begin to say what it meant to me to be blessed by her and by my father before the ark? Jacob had his angels. These are mine. And there is one more crew I would thank, my college roommates, who have come from across the country with their families to be here tonight. They know me too well. And they are no doubt thinking, this cannot be the same Schlemiel we knew. Eleven years ago, at the Oneg Shabbat following my installation in Chappaqua, where I had already been serving a number of months, after all the beautiful hyperbole, an older member of the congregation approached me with a warm smile and said, with all sincerity and sweetness, Rabbi, we had no idea you were so wonderful. Don't be fooled, I answered. But what I promised her, I promise you. I will do everything in my power to serve you and to lead you, so that Temple Emanu-El becomes the place not of my dreams, but of our dreams, a sacred community for all the times and seasons of our lives, where we immerse ourselves in the beauty of our tradition and act on its values in the world around us, where we celebrate and find comfort, learn and grow together. Filled then with awe and humility, I gratefully assume the pulpit of this holy congregation, and I say with Jacob, Ma nora hamakom hazeh, ein zeh ki im beit Elohim v'zeh sha'ar hashamayim. How filled with awe is this place, this moment. For me, this is truly the abode of God, the gate of heaven. Thank you very, very much.
Oh! Emanu, vehigianu lazman hazeh.
Shehigianu vehigianu, vehigianu lazman hazeh. Shehigianu vehigianu, vehigianu lazman hazeh.
Shehigianu vehigianu, vehigianu lazman hazeh.
Continue in the prayer book on page 71. May the time not be distant, O God, when thy name shall be worshipped in all the earth, when unbelief shall disappear and error be no more. Fervently we pray that the day may come when all shall invoke thy name, when corruption and evil shall give way to purity and goodness, when superstition shall no longer enslave the mind, nor idolatry blind the eye, when all who dwell on earth shall know that to thee alone every knee must bend and every tongue give homage. O may all created in thine image recognize that they are brethren, so that one in spirit and one in fellowship, they may be forever united before thee. Then shall thy kingdom be established on earth and the word of thine ancient seer be fulfilled. The Lord will reign forever and ever.
Venema.
nature's ebb and flow, God's eternal law abides. When tears dim our vision and grief clouds our understanding, we often lose sight of God's eternal plan. Yet we know that growth and decay, life and death, all reveal God's purpose. He who is our support in the struggles of life is also our hope in death. We have set God before us and shall not despair. In his hands are the souls of all the living and the spirits of all flesh. Under God's protection we abide, and by his love are we comforted. O life of our life, soul of our soul, cause thy light to shine into our hearts and fill our spirit with abiding trust in thee. As we turn our hearts to remembrance, let us honor the life and achievements of Nelson Mandela, a moral exemplar for us all, by rising for Kaddish found on pages 77 and 78. We say together, Yiskadal v'yiskadash shemei rabah, v'yomadi v'rach yuse v'yam lich malchuse, v'chayichon v'yomechon v'chayedichol beis Yisrael, v'agalaviz man kariv imru amen, Hey Shemei Rabbah Mivorach Leolam Almei Omaya Yisbarach Vyishtabach Vyispoar Vyisromam Vyisnase Vyisadar Vyisalev Vyishalal Shemei Dekudisha Brihu Leelamin Kol Birchasa Vyishirasa Tushbechasa Vynechemasa Deamiram Vyoma Vyimru Ami Yehesh Lama Rabbah Min Shemaya Vyachayim Aleinu v'al kol Yisrael v'imru amen. Oseh shalom b'imromav, hu ya'aseh shalom. Aleinu v'al kol Yisrael v'imru amen. At this time of tender memory, we also call to mind and mention by name Dorothy Mitzner, a cherished member of our own congregational family. And all of us, we name in our hearts those dear ones who have entered into the peace of life eternal. They still live on earth in the acts of goodness they performed, and in the hearts of those who cherish their memories. May the beauty of their lives abide among us as a loving benediction, and may the source of peace send peace to all who mourn, and comfort all the bereaved among us. And let us say together, Amen. I'd like to invite Dr. Gail S. Davidson, Rabbi Davidson's mother, and his brother Jeremy to the Bima to light the Sabbath candles and recite Kiddush.
Come, let us welcome the Sabbath. May its radiance illumine our hearts as we kindle these tapers. Light is the symbol of the divine The Lord is my light and my salvation. Light is the symbol of the divine in humanity. The spirit of humanity is the light of the Lord. Light is the symbol of the divine law, for the commandment is a lamp and the law is a light. Light is the symbol of Israel's mission. I, the Lord, have set thee for a covenant of the people, for a light unto the nations. Therefore, in the spirit of our ancient tradition that hallows and unites Israel in all lands and all ages, do we now kindle the Sabbath lights. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, asher kidshanu b'mitzvotav, v'tzivanu lahadlik ner shel Shabbat.
Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, berei peri hagafen. Mikol ha'amin v'shabbat.
And we welcome our Benot Mitzvah, Shana Stein and Glynis Reed for Motzi. On behalf of the clergy and the entire congregation, we'd like to present you both with certificates marking this moment of blessing in your lives, and a gift, a sterling silver kiddush cup. May your cups overflow with the sweetness and joy of our tradition. May you always go from strength to strength and from blessing to blessing. Mazel tov to you and to your family.
Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Hamotzi Lechem Mim Haaretz.
Amen.
How wonderful to celebrate with you this evening, and how grateful we are for your being here tonight. We look forward to the opportunity to continue the celebration downstairs at our festive Onyx Shabbat. We ask you to remain in the sanctuary and in your seats until those on the Bima have completed the recessional. They have promised to move briskly. Also, please leave your books in your seats. I promise somebody will take them away. Marcia?
It's an honor and a pleasure to be here this Shabbat on this historic occasion for the installation of Rabbi Joshua Davidson as the 16th senior rabbi of our congregation. How fortunate we are to have two senior rabbis emeriti with us. Rabbi Ronald Sobel, who began this memorable service with the opening prayer. And we've witnessed the Torah being passed both physically and symbolically from the hands of Rabbi David Posner into the worthy hands of Rabbi Joshua Davidson, a true continuation of Emanuel's great legacy. Now, as the service is about to close, we can reflect on the words spoken by so many who have been a part of Rabbi Davidson's life. We are confident and know in our hearts our future is bright. Rabbi Davidson is our rabbi, our leader, and our teacher. He will be a strong presence in all of our lives.
Rabbi David Gelfand and Cantor Ellen Dreskin were important influences in Rabbi Davidson's early years. Both of them entered his life when he was still a boy, when they led the youth program at Temple Beth El in Great Neck. At that time, Rabbi Gelfand was the elder Rabbi Davidson's associate. Josh Davidson would later work for Rabbi Gelfand as an intern at Fairmont Temple in Cleveland, where he was reunited with Cantor Ellen and her husband, Rabbi Billy Dreskin. When Rabbi Davidson went to Woodlands Community Temple in White Plains, he was again fortunate to work with the Dreskins. The connection continued when Cantor Dreskin went on to work with Rabbi Davidson at Temple Beth El in Chappaqua.
And now, as we conclude our service, truly a milestone celebration, we call on Rabbi David Gelfand and Cantor Ellen Dreskin to deliver the benediction. Rabbi Gelfand and Cantor Dreskin, we are honored to receive your blessings.
We stand here on this special night in this historic congregation as witness, just as do you. And as you have heard, we stand here not so much as a rabbi and cantor, though that we are. We stand here somewhere between family and those college roommates. It depended on the day. Your new rabbi has lived in our house, in each of our homes at different times, as we have in his. Our lives have been filled with shared blessings and opportunities, with moments of great joy and moments of shared sadness. It is said that the rabbis first met at the great assembly, and then across the generations there were others who came and stood and spoke words of Torah, including your rabbis of note, your emeriti rabbis. For us, we were deeply touched by Rabbi Jerome K. Davidson, and because of that, we were inspired to share unto another generation, as you heard with a kid. He was about half as tall, and we had no gray hair. And so now here we stand. We speak not alone for ourselves, Josh. We speak not only for the congregants where we have worked together, but so too for those here from Chappaqua and from Central, and so many others of your colleagues who hold you in such great regard. And we stand like the rabbis of the great assembly to give testimony. There is no better way to do it than to reflect on the words and spirit of our children, each of them. We have known you and watched you. You have stood at their brises and at their baby names. And they know you as your congregants have come to know you, a reflection of the elegance of your family across the generations whom we have known, your parents and grandparents. Not only the elegance, but the eloquence of your parents. And not only that, but the soul of a passionate voice for truth and a deep teacher of Torah. Your new rabbi, Rabbi Joshua Davidson, does not just believe in teaching Torah, though he is masterful at that. But as even for us, he is a living embodiment of Torah. And as the sages have taught us, it is not enough to study Torah. It is a commandment, as it were, to be Torah. May God give your rabbi the strength and courage to do so. And may this sacred congregation be blessed with him now and for long years to come, as a kehila kedoshah, a sacred community built on trust, on the warmth of his humor, the strength of his courage. And through that, may your family be blessed, those of yesterday, today, and yet of tomorrow. And so may it be for each of us and for this great congregation. With your rabbi leading you, guiding you, teaching you, and being with you, may God bless you and watch over you, and may God bless him.
Amen. Yaher Adonai
as your rabbi for nearly 40 years has brought brightness into our lives. May you accept the brightness, the wisdom, and the courage that he now brings to you. The legacy of the pulpit of Emanu-El ring loudly in your hearts and minds, and may the clarion voice of Rabbi Davidson inspire you to be your best for today and for tomorrow, and together may you be blessed in peace.
Amen.